going till the sun fell down. It kept it going.
So good afternoon. Why don't we go ahead and get started? So I'm Rahul Mathur, CFO. I wanted to say thank you very much for joining us at our Analyst Day. Delighted to be here. We have certain members of our management team, including Luke Serafin, our CEO, here as well. And we have a presentation that's also available on our website. We'll go through our presentation, and then it'll be available to download after our presentation is over. Just in terms of the order of operations, after my brief introduction, Luke will spend a lot of time more talking about our company, and I'll come back to shed some more light on our financials. Then we'll have our management team come up and join us for any questions that you may have about us or our company. I want to start off just with our obligatory safe harbor statement. Obviously, we'll be making some forward-looking statements today, not just about this quarter, but this year and next year as well. I'd encourage you to read our filings that are there with the SEC. I think they provide a lot of useful content about our company, and certainly more than we can provide just in a short conversation. So with that, what I'll do is I'll turn it back to Luke to kick off.
Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to New York City. Welcome to this wonderful building, and welcome to our 2019 Analyst Day. The way we are going to structure the presentation today is I'm going to introduce the management team. I'm going to talk about the end markets that we are targeting as a company and why they're relevant to us. We'll talk about how we're going to describe our business going forward. We spent a lot of time over the last year trying to simplify our business in the decisions we've made. We also want to simplify the way we present our business so that it's easier for you guys to track what we do. I'll talk a bit about our product offering and its relevance to the target markets we have. And finally, something that we think is very important to us, we're going to talk about our R&D activities and how they fuel our patent portfolio, because we had a lot of questions on that topic, and I think it's important that we cover that. So with this, I'll start with this very simple slide that kind of captures who we are. We are RAM bus. It means that we make memory and high-speed interface, RAM, and we move data. We move and we secure data, and that's how we want to position the company. We want to be understandable by the market, and that's how we are being understood by the market. So I'll start by introducing the management team. Some of the people are here. You see there's been a lot of changes over the last year, so let me take a few minutes to introduce the people. So if you look at the top row on the right side, this is Kit Rogers. Kit is there. Kit has been with us many, many years. He's coming from CRI, the embedded security company that we bought years back. Kit has been front and center in our patent licensing negotiation, and is also in charge of our M&A and corporate development activities. So you have an opportunity to meet with Kit today. Next to Kit is Jerome. Our CMO is not here today. He's in Europe. Jeff Moore, next to him, is our head of operation. Jeff Moore is coming from Fairchild. He's the one who has been behind the infrastructure we put in place to become a chip company. Very good experience in supply chain management in particular. The next one on next to Jeff, is our friend Rahul, who's going to talk after me. Next is Jay Kim, our general counsel. And finally, we have the pleasure of having Sean Fan with us. Sean is there. Sean just joined us 3 weeks ago from IDT, where he was running 4 business units there, including the buffer chip business unit. The way we've organized the team is that all of our product activities are going to now report to Sean. So you have Gary Bronner here. Gary's experience has been with us for a long time, but before that he was with IBM Research. And Gary is looking at all the innovations that we have to go through in the memory space, and he reports to Sean. Krishna is our head of a design center in India. Niraj is also, Palwal is also someone we hired from the industry. He was in charge of the security business at NXP, and he's in charge of our security business now. Hemant Dula is in charge of our IP business. His background is with Xilinx and Intel. And finally, Chen-Sin Lee joined us years back now from Infi, and his background was in the buffer chip business. So as you can see, we've simplified the structure of the management team, we're focusing the management team, and we brought talents from the industry to help us grow the company. At the beginning of the year, we laid out a few priorities for the business, and some of you are very familiar with those. The first one was to refocus our product portfolio and R&D around our core strengths in semiconductors, in particular, memory interfaces, high-speed interfaces, and embedded security. We also put a lot of effort in optimizing our operational efficiency by leveraging the synergies that we have between our different businesses and across our customer base. And finally, we leverage our ability to generate cash from operations to amplify our market and technology growth. And you'll see some of the things we've done over the past few months. A brief summary of what has happened over the last year. If you look at the top line, this has to do with the strategy that we laid out a few months back. In the end of Q3 of last year, we announced that we would be looking for strategic options for our payment and ticketing business. Remember, payment and ticketing business was very successful, but it plays in a set of markets and in an environment that is far afield to our core. So to allow them to continue to grow and to allow us to continue to focus on our strengths, we decided to divest that business. In Q2 of this year, we announced that Visa would acquire a payment and ticketing business, and you know, we are in the final stage of that process as we speak. The other thing that we did on the strategic side is very recently in Q3, we announced the acquisition of Northwest Logic, a provider of memory and SerDes controllers and MIPI controllers that really complement our PHY business in the IP space. And we also signed an exclusivity agreement to acquire the embedded security business of Verimatrics, originally known as Insight Secure, that strengthened our position in the embedded security space. So on this strategy, we made a few moves. Two of them just happened this quarter to strengthen our position on our core business. On the product side, we've made a few announcements over the year about the progress we've made with our crypto manager. The first one was with Micron, the announcement we made in Q4 of last year. We've expanded our crypto manager business with other customers that we don't name in AI and in consumer space, and that happened in Q2 of this year. We've made some good progress in the IP core business by announcing the release of our 32 gig and 112 gig SerDes. These SerDes are extremely important in markets like 5G, for example, or the next generation of network infrastructure. On the licensing business, the last quarter of last year was very busy. We had a lot of critical renewals. Our friend Kit was very busy doing this. We renewed our licensing businesses deals with Broadcom, NVIDIA, and Phison. And last but not least, as we do all of this, as we redefine the company and refocus the company, we continue to generate a lot of cash from our operations. Last quarter, we generated $38.7 million of cash while we were doing all of these activities. So that summarizes what has happened over the last year. As I said, we had a sequence of announcements over the last few months. The sale to Visa of our payment and ticketing business going through its final stages of completion. We acquired, and I'll say a few more words about this later, we acquired the business of Northwest Logic in the controller space, and we made an announcement to acquire the embedded security business from Verimatrics, known as Insight Secure. This slide is a good summary of what we want to be and what space we are playing in. And if you look at the bottom of that slide, what you see is you see a list of technology suppliers. And you know, if we want to define who we are in terms of what neighborhood we play in, then that would be there. You know, typically our competitors in the IP core space, whether it's SerDes, memory, or security, are companies like Cadence and Synopsys or ARM. Typically, our competitors on the chip side, our real competitors today on the chip side, are IDT and Montage. So this gives you an idea of what space, what markets we're trying to address. We have a very strong relationship with the foundries, Samsung, TSMC, and GlobalFoundries, for a very particular reason. This particular reason is that when you develop memory interfaces PHY, or SerDes interfaces PHYs, these PHYs are based on analog technologies that are dependent on the technology node that is being used. So we need to have a very strong relationship with the foundries every time we develop a PHY. And that gave us that strong relationship with those companies. If you go to the next level, this is a short list, a very short list of our customers. You see names like the memory vendors, or Qualcomm or Intel. There's a long list of customers. But I think what's important here is what you can see is a lot of these customers are licensees. They were licensees of our companies years back. And over time, what we've done is we've reinvested the cash that we get from these companies to develop solutions and technologies that they need. So our relationship with those customers is much broader than a licensing relationship. It's a product, technology, and licensing relationship. The next layer talks about the OEMs. The OEMs are extremely important for us because they define the cadence of introduction of new platforms in the market. That's extremely important for us, especially in the buffer chip business, because they define when the next generation of products is going to be deployed in the market. It's also very important because they help us define what we need to have in our products and anticipate those needs when we build those products. And finally, the cloud providers are becoming increasingly important for us for two reasons. One is cloud providers are starting to develop their own architectures around processors and memory as they address new needs in the market, in particular, around AI. And they also are in high demand of embedded security because they play in the cloud. So we have a growing relationship with those companies in the cloud. And on the top line, what you see is that originally Rambus was known to play mostly in the data center space because we were focusing on memory. But there's a renaissance of interest for memory technologies and embedded security technologies in a lot of different markets. And I'm going to describe a few of them as we move forward. Here, what we see is the markets we are playing in. So we're known for playing in the data center and networking. We have great traction in automotive, in Internet of Things, AI, edge computing, and government. I'm going to click down on a few of them to explain why these markets are very relevant to us and why we decided to refocus the company on memory interfaces, high-speed interfaces, and embedded security. So let's start with the data center networking. Everyone knows that chart that shows the explosion of data that we are all experiencing. And it's mind-boggling. You know, the scale on the left side is in zettabytes, and people just have trouble understanding what a zettabyte is. I try to find myself. So a zettabyte is a billion gigabyte. So, and you see the market size in this range of 20 or 40 zettabytes, billions of gigabytes. It's very difficult to fathom what it means. But I think the way to look at this is to look at our life every day with our mobile phones. You know, people don't know, they are probably in the cloud 4 or 5 trillion pictures stored, you know, every year. You know, every minute there's maybe 120, 130 million emails being sent, 16 million texts. It is really mind-boggling. There are 1.5 billion people active at every moment on Facebook. So that creates an amount of data that is really, really difficult to deal with. And I think the expectation is for all of us of real-time access to that data. So the way that chart translates to us is that as you see this exponential growth of data, if you want to have real-time access to that data, it means that we will have to have this exponential increase in the speed of the solutions we provide. You know, if you want to have access to something that is 10 times bigger in the same time, then you have to go 10 times faster. And that's what this company has been doing for the last 30 years. This company has been developing high-speed interfaces that go faster and faster to access larger amounts of data faster. And that's why that chart is very relevant to us. The data center market is a large market for us. We estimate the TAM to be $800 million with a lot of design starts, with a growth that is a modest growth of 8%. But that's the bread and butter of what we do. What you see in the center of that slide is the types of products that we have to address that market. And in the case of Rambus, you know, all of our product portfolio have a role to play in the data center space. Chips, buffer chips, memory PHYs, memory controllers, SerDes PHYs, SerDes controllers, security cores, and security provisioning. Every one of those products has a role to play in the data center space. So as I said, this is the largest target market for us, with good growth and a very nice focus of our product offering for that market. Now, if I move to new markets like AI, you know, AI is one of these transformational aspects of the market that we can benefit from. AI is based on the concept of learning and then making inference about these learning, training and making inferences. To train an AI system, you have to train the AI system with tons and tons of data. You have to give, for example, zillions of voice samples for an AI system to train to recognize your voice. So AI is actually in very, very high demand of data and data bandwidth. The higher speed and higher bandwidth type of solutions that we offer to the market go to AI type of applications. And there's a very interesting interdependence between AI and the amount of data we have to deal with. We, as people, cannot make sense of that amount of data that is out there without AI. We need AI system to make sense of data. At the same time, AI systems can deliver good quality results, you know, if they can train on a lot of data. So it's right in the middle of what we do, and that's why we have all of these new design wins in that space. And if we do the same analysis as we did for data centers, you can see that the AI market TAM is smaller, $225 million, according to us, and that the number of designs is quite nice, but the growth of that market is much nicer than the growth that we have in the data center. So we have that view of a very large market, data center, $800 million TAM, with a growth of about 8%, and an AI market that is growing much faster, smaller market today, but growing at a much faster rate. And what you can see here as well is that the type of products that we have elected to play in are very relevant to the AI space. So in the AI space, we sell memory PHYs, memory controllers, SerDes PHYs, SerDes controllers, security cores, and security provisioning. The only thing we don't sell into AI today is buffer chip. So let me move to IoT. So IoT is a new source of data. What we talked about earlier was what we as human need in terms of data. We talked about pictures, we talked about Facebook, we talked all the things that matter to us. Now with this emergence of connected devices, we have a whole new set of data, which is the data we read from connected devices. And here, one of the concerns of the whole industry is how do we make sure that the data we read is secure and is authentic, so that we can use that data for whatever service we want to base on that data. So the IoT market is still smaller for us in terms of time, $60 million, but there's a very large number of design starts and a nice growth as well. And the way we play in the IoT market is memory controllers, SerDes controllers, security cores, and security provisioning. Again, a very nice fit of what we do with what these markets require. So if we lump all of this together with the other segments that I did not describe in more detail, what we see is we have a sum of $625 million, meaning that, you know, if we stop developing, you know, any products and stop acquiring, this is the market that we're looking at today, $625 million for our product offering. That excludes the licensing business. Now, if we go to the next circle, the SAM is $1.4 billion. And, you know, we make dents into the SAM when we do acquisitions, for example. You know, when we acquire Northwest Logic or when we acquire Verimetrics, we acquire technologies that are very close to our core and we can address that SAM of $1.4 billion. The TAM of $2 billion takes into account the fact that some of our customers do develop their technologies themselves in-house. And if they were to have external companies develop those technologies, then the TAM would be $2 billion for us. So in a nutshell, this is what we do and why we do it. You know, originally, we were a company in the memory space, mostly addressing the data center space. We see a renaissance of memory architectures and the need for embedded security due to the emergence of AI IoT, automotive, and other types of markets. So it's a kind of a rebirth for Rambus, and it was important for us to double down on the technologies that we master as we address these shifts in the market. Now, as I said earlier, we wanted to simplify the way we present ourselves. There was a lot of effort for people who follow us. There was a lot of effort to simplify ourselves internally, to be clear about what we want to be, what we want to develop, what markets we want to go after, and that's what we just described. I think it's important for us also to try to be clearer and more understandable to the external world, including you know, the financial community. So the way you know us is this way. We had the memory and interface division and the security division, and we were addressing each one of those divisions with these three ways of going to market: architecture license, which is basically patent licensing, interface IP, which is basically IP cores, and chips. In the case of security, we had the same thing. We have patent licensing, we have IP cores, and we had payment and ticketing, which was part of our business. So as we simplified our business, we got rid of payment and ticketing. As I said, payment and ticketing was growing nicely, but in a very different market. It was very distracting, and it was preventing us from investing in what we are good at. So we divested payment and ticketing. The next thing that we're doing is we're simplifying, you know, the way we look at our business. On one side, we have our patent licensing business, which embraces everything we do in mid and RSD, in security and memory space. We have a IP business that is very similar in terms of how we go to market between our security IP and our interface IP, mostly because our customers are semiconductor companies, and the type of contracts we have are very, very similar with those companies. And on the right side, we have a chip engagement, which is a standard chip engagement. So we think that the way to present our business as delivering technology in the embedded security space, in the high-speed memory interface, in the form of architecture license, IP, and products is a simpler way of describing our business. So the new Rambus is the way to look at this. We have an architecture license business. We have a silicon IP business that embraces everything we do in security and IP cores, and we have a chip business, and we deliver those technologies to the market through these three channels. And hopefully that will simplify the way we describe our business. And I think Rahul is going to talk in more detail about how financially we're going to describe this to allow you to understand us better. What I'm going to do now is give a brief introduction of the product offering that we have in place to address all of these target segments. The first one is the memory buffer chip. A lot of you are very familiar with this, but the memory buffers are expanding the capacity for data centers. They sit between the memory, the DRAM memory banks and the processors. I think what's important to know for us is that today, the buffer chip business is playing in the generation of DDR4. But DDR4 has several flavors. You know, every time a processor vendor introduces a new processor, or every time a memory vendor introduces a new version of their memory, of DRAM memory, there is an opportunity for us to gain share by winning designs with our customers, our direct customers, those memory vendors, and their customers that we looked at earlier. And the growth that you see in our buffer chip business is stemming directly from our ability to win designs every time there was a change in that market, either a new processor or a new memory being introduced in the market. We've seen very nice growth in that business, as we said earlier, you know, more than 40% growth year over year in that business. You know, that business is going to be anything between $50 and $70 million this year and will continue to grow. So very, very nice business. And all of this is coming from the DDR4 space. We have a nice niche business in the non-volatile buffer chip space. I'm saying niche just because the end market is a niche, not because we have a small share. We have a big share of a niche. And that's, you know, one of the technologies where we adapt our buffer chip to hybrid systems, where we want to mix flash memory with DRAM. So I just wanted to mention that because this is a nice growth for us. This is also a very interesting system work that we do with some of our customers. And on the right side, as you know, we were the first ones to introduce DB chips and RCD chips for the DDR5 market. We expect DDR5, you know, to sample next year, you know, volume not before 2021 at the earlier. So there's a lot of business to be done in DDR4 before we go to DDR5. But the very fact that we were first in DDR5 in sampling is very comforting for us because history showed that when you're first to market and engage with the ecosystem earlier, then typically you drive a large market share. This was the case for Inphi in the DDR3 space. This was the case in DDR4 with IDT. And we expect that you know, this will continue to be the case for us with DDR5. Let me explain what we do in silicon IP, IP cores, and why it is relevant to the markets that we talked about. If you look at a card in a server here and a processor, you can see all the areas where the IP cores are relevant. So on the left, on the left side, you have memory interconnects. You know, all types of memories that you can address, you know, with this processor card. You know, HBM2, GDDR, DDR, LPDDR. You know, all of these memory interfaces are offered as by Rambus, and we've complemented this with the memory controllers that go with it with the acquisition of Northwest Logic. Every card on the backplane potentially connects to long reach 56 gig, 112 gig SerDes. Same thing, these are developments that we have internally. You have chip-to-chip interconnects, PCIe 3, 4, 5, 112 gig medium range, 28 gig. Again, all sorts of SerDes that we develop in-house. And when we bought Northwest Logic, we complement those SerDes with a controller that goes with it. And some people are talking about chiplets, which is, you know, interface chip that sit between different chips that build large systems. So our strategy here was to focus on high-speed interfaces because this is hard to do. The barriers to entry are very, very high for people who are trying to do that. And to focus on increasing the ASP that we offer to our customers by, you know, buying, for example, the controllers from Northwest Logic. Because for every design that we have for a PHY, there's a potential design for a controller. A side effect of that, as I explained earlier, when you design a PHY, you are dependent on the technology node and the foundry that you work on. But when you design a controller, you're not. So what it means is that our Northwest Logic friends, or our Northwest Logic employees now, have had a very interesting reach to the market because they were not dependent on technologies. You know, this is a synthesizable IP. This slide shows the complementarity of Rambus and Northwest Logic. So we originally developed PHYs for DDR4, GDDR6, HBM2, PCIe. We didn't develop PHYs for MIPI. Northwest Logic had almost a mirror image of what we do in the controller space. And this was a very natural move for us to do that because we increase content in our end customers. We also improve time to market because the interoperability of the PHY with the controller is much easier when you're both part of the same company. So you can actually work on systems that work together much faster and you can get to market much faster. And at the bottom, you see the markets that we're addressing, which match what we talked about earlier in our presentation. So let me switch to embedded security because we made an announcement recently. Embedded security is about protecting semiconductors and their secrets from design through manufacturing and deployment. And as I explained earlier to some of you, there are two parts of what we offer. There are secure IP cores that are embedded in silicon, where typically you store secret keys. And when you access these secret keys with a mirror key, you have the possibility of enabling or stopping or changing things in a secure way. And we provide the infrastructure that allows you to provision those keys to these embedded silicon. This is very, very important. People are becoming more and more aware of the need for security and the risk of having all of these IoT devices, for example, being insecure. I was reading recently some articles about what happened, I think, in 2017 in Dallas, where 156 sirens started to ring in the city for 2 hours because they were hacked. And it flooded the 9/11 numbers. People in the middle of the night were panicking about what was going on. It is very important that every time you use a device that is not connected to a human, that you make sure that this device is secured, that it's authentic, and that the data that you send from that device or you send to this device is data that you can trust. So that's what we do. What you see on the right side is the product offering that we currently have before the acquisition of Verimatrics. But the next slide shows, you know, how we complement each other with the silicon IP of Verimatrics. As you can see, we both provide secure silicon IP. We both have, you know, different segments. But one interesting aspect of what we did with Verimatrics is that originally, Rambus was about securing data at rest. You're securing the data that sits in a piece of protected silicon in the chip. Verimatrics adds to this the ability to secure data in motion. And there are markets, for example, in the networking space where you need to encrypt the data before it exits the chip for security reasons. And Verimatrics brings that capability that we didn't have in-house. So it's very complementary from that, you know, from that standpoint. They also bring secure software protocols, and they also have their own secure provisioning system. With the acquisition of Verimatrics, number one, Verimatrics can focus on their own business, which is higher up in the software stacks. So it was good for them. And for us, it reinforces our position as a leader in embedded security systems. For the silicon market, the semiconductor market. So now that we have an overview of the current product offering, and as we talked earlier about our effort to refocus the company, I just want to spend a few words about what we do in R&D. You remember one of the aspects of this refocusing of the company was the moves we made through M&A. The divestiture of our payment and ticketing business to Visa, the acquisition of Northwest Logic in the controller space, the acquisition of Verimatrics in the embedded security space. This is all part of refocusing the company. But we've had some efforts in refocusing the company internally as well. We've cut programs in the R&D space that did not have customer traction. And we've redirected those R&D dollars into areas that make sense for our short-term and long-term future, in particular to our licensing programs. Licensing programs is a very important part of our business. It generates cash, it's stable, it's long-term, and it's very important for us that we continue to invest in that program. So there are three, in the memory space, there are three areas where we spend our R&D dollars. The first one is extending the performance of DRAM for future generation. And basically what it means is that what do we think are going to be the techniques required when we go beyond DDR5 into DDR6, when we go beyond GDDR6 into GDDR7, and so on and so forth. So we have a group of people who look at techniques that we think are going to be relevant to these next generation memory that are not in the market yet. We're just inventing, we're just producing invention, we're just patenting what we can patent, and all of these activities under Gary's group here. The second area we invest in R&D is the next generation hybrid memory subsystems. And this is the techniques that we think are going to be relevant when we want to mix on a memory bus some volatile memory like DRAM and some non-volatile memory like flash, and what system requirements are going to be. And again, we're trying to invent techniques that we think are going to be relevant when those technologies are going to be widespread in the market. And finally, the third area we're investing in is the application-specific memory solutions, in particular for artificial intelligence. As we said earlier, the current memory subsystem architectures that we use for data centers are not optimal for new applications like AI. AI requires a lot of data for training in particular. So we need to find ways of increasing bandwidth and bringing processing closer to the data itself. So that requires different types of memory architectures. And this is an area that we think is going to be very relevant in the future and where we invest our R&D dollars as well. So I thought it was very important for this community to understand that above and beyond the growth that we generate with our IP cores and buffer chip, we also invest in, you know, the future of memory and security because we think it's going to be really relevant for us. This chart shows the number of patent grants and the number of publications, which is the patent request. We don't have the grant yet that we've had over the last few years. And you can see the lower part of the stack bar is the patent grants. And you can see a small decline over the last 3 years. But what you can see as well on the yellow part of that, the top part of the stack bar, is the number of grants, is the number of publications, excuse me. The number of publications is increasing rapidly. As I said earlier, as we refocused our R&D dollars onto relevant technologies, we have increased our publications to enrich our patent portfolio. It's very important for us. What I would add to this is that our current patent portfolio is still relevant because patents have a long lifetime. But it's also important for us to continue to feed that portfolio with new grants. We have about 2,600 patents or patents applications, which makes us one of the largest owner as an independent company in that space. The other thing that I think is important to understand, because we have that question many times, is, so where do these patents apply, and why are they so relevant to the industry? And there's a confusion sometimes that we develop patents in the core memory technology, and that's not the case. We develop patents in the memory interface, in the interface technology. So if you look on the left side of that chart here, and these yellow boxes, they describe where we develop our patents. So this is the interface to DRAM or the interface to flash. We have more than 1,500 patents and applications related to DRAM and flash interfaces. And the types of technologies that we address, they span from DDR3, DDR4, DDR5, LPDDR3, LPDDR4, LPDDR5, GDR5, GDR6, HBM. So it's much broader than the products that we have in our portfolio. We try to look at all kinds of memory interfaces from the patent licensing standpoint. And what's nice for us is that whatever memory the industry is going to deploy, that memory is going to have a memory interface. And that's where we play. The next one is chip-to-chip interface. We have 500 patents and applications related to the serial links. The product relevance is for PCIe, 10 gigabit Ethernet, USB, and DisplayPort. Again, because it sits at the interface, it's relevant to a lot of standards. So it's relevant to a large number of companies in the industry. And finally, in the security space, we have more than 100 patents and applications related to security and DPA. And the product relevance are in all of these standards that are needed to provide secure solutions to the market. I think it was very important that we clarify that because it's extremely important to our future. And looping this back to what we talked about earlier in terms of relevant market, when there's an explosion of data, there will be an explosion of interfaces to that data. This is a mega trend. and our ability to continue to develop a patent portfolio that applies to all of these interfaces is extremely important for us when we see that megatrend. The other thing that we are aware of is that when there's an explosion of data, there's an explosion of risk for that data to be compromised. So it's really, really important for us to continue to invest in foundational technology that protects data. And that's why you've seen what you've seen over the last year, us refocusing our company to memory interfaces and embedded security for the IP we provide, for the chips we provide, but also for the patent portfolio that we develop for our licensing program. This is an eye chart, but I wanted to show that chart because it's a description of the types of technologies we touch when we have a patent application. And the reason I wanted to touch to show that chart is that if you look on the left side, we touch every part of a memory system. We touch the memory devices, the control signals, the data signals, the clock signals, the memory controller, the IC. Every part of a memory system is something that we have invention in. And I think this chart shows very clearly that although we only have 2,650 patents and applications, which is a large number, they're very, very focused in a very specific area. And that area is memory and security, because we think that these two megatrends are going to drive growth for us. This chart is interesting as well. The art aspect of it is very interesting, but this basically this shows, this is a representation of the citation that these companies have when they ask for a patent. So they have to cite, you know, companies that they think you know have prior art. So, for example, you know, this is the number of times that Intel cited Rambus as a potential prior art company in that space. And to give you an idea, the Micron, for example, this is the size of about 400, I think, four to 500 citations. But what you can see here is that every company that is relevant in that space cites Rambus as having potential prior art in that space. So we are recognized as being leaders in those in those spaces. So in summary, we are Rambus. I'll keep saying this. We move and we secure data, and we think it's going to be extremely important given the megatrends that we see in the explosion of data used by humans but used by machines as well, and the need for embedded security. So we're focusing on our core strengths in those spaces. Our strong patent portfolio has continued relevance, and we continue to invent in those spaces. We have a predictable cash generation that we reinvest in R&D and M&A. As you know, last quarter we generated $38 million of cash from our operations. And we are delivering to high growth market segments. So that summarizes who we are. And I'll be happy to take questions after Rahul talks to you about our financials. Thank you.
Luke, thank you again for the overview. What I'll do is I'll go through some slides that help provide a little more color about our financials. We'll start with this slide 34. So we are reaffirming the guidance that we provided for Q3. So you don't have to do too much of the mental math. This is exactly the same numbers that we had when we reported our Q2 results and guided for Q3. It's been a great quarter for us, and I've been really excited about the traction that we've had in all aspects of our business. Obviously, there's still a couple of weeks left in our quarter, so we'll see where we end up in our range. One point to remind you is that the guidance that we provided for Q3 excludes the results for the payments and ticketing business that we're in the process of divesting to Visa. So I know Kit and Jay and team are working arduously on trying to close that as soon as we can. It's not clear whether we'll be able to close it by the end of Q3 or not. but working closely. But what we've done is we've taken out any impact of the payments and ticketing business. Now, as a reminder for that business and many other businesses that are in the process of going through a strategic change, what we see is customers essentially pausing to do new paper with Visa. So from an accounting perspective, you know, we'll still have the same rough expenses on a quarterly basis that we would expect, but I'd expect our revenue in that business would be lower than what we would have done otherwise. When I report results for Q3, what I'll do is I'll give you those numbers separately, so you'll see what the revenue and expenses associated with payments and ticketing is, so you can exclude it from our results. But again, we're reaffirming the guidance that we provided about Q3. Let me talk a little bit about our revenue and licensing billings. For those of you that know us well are aware, the new accounting standard that we've had to implement last year called ASC 606 had a substantial impact in terms of how we report our financial results. It hasn't had an impact on the underlying core strength of our business, and one of the oddities of the accounting change is it really highlights how strong that cash flow and how predictable that cash flow stream is. So just as a reminder, in our previous accounting standard for ASC 605, if we were to sign a new customer contract that was $400 million, so $25 million a quarter for 4 years, we would recognize revenue ratably over the course of those 4 years. So every quarter, we would recognize $25 million as we billed our partners and then collected from them. ASC 606 changes that revenue recognition standard. What ASC 606 does is says that if you don't have a performance obligation in that contract, you take the entire value of the contract in the period in which you sign it. So that same $400 million contract, the period in which we signed the agreement, we'd take roughly $400 million of revenue, we'd put the balance that we hadn't yet collected on our balance sheet as an unbilled contract receivable. And then every quarter, as we bill and collect from our customers, you'd see that receivable come off of our balance sheet. Under ASC 606, what we would also do is record interest income every quarter. So that's the imputed interest that we've given to our partners for those extended payment terms. So it's been a big change for us, and what I would tell you is that both internally as well as the analysts who cover our stock, what they've done is often just replaced what we had historically reported as royalty revenue, so revenue associated with those partners and contracts, with what we now report in licensing billings. So if you look at this slide here, slide 35, it's the same slide we published at the earnings last year. What you'll see is that in 2018, as we were going through our transition, we were able to publish numbers both under ASC 606 as well as 605. We were required to show that reconciliation between 606 and 605. And what you see is those numbers side by side. So royalty revenue for us under ASC 606 for 2018 was $130 million. However, what you see on ASC 605 is, had we still been under ASC 605, it would have been a little over $300. Now, if you go down to the second series of rows there, what you see that our licensing billings for fiscal year 2018 was about $301, and that compares very favorably to what we reported as royalty revenue under ASC 605. So again, from a cash flow perspective, our actual cash flow mimics what we had reported on licensing billings, and that's the metric that we use operationally to gauge the performance of our company. What I wanted to do is actually spend now a little more time talking about what Luke had described earlier in terms of changing the way that we think about our company and talking about our company as well. One of the things that attracted me to Rambus 3 years ago was these predictable long-term licensing arrangements that we have, where we have no performance obligation and will continue to collect hundreds of millions of dollars on an annual basis because of our strong patent portfolio. What you see on the left chart is what we report as licensing billings. Again, that operational metric. And what you see is that operational metric for billings staying roughly flat. What I've talked about historically is we have a backbone of our business related to our IP business, which is about $300 million. That's typically been about $250 million from an architectural license perspective and about a $50 million chunk from our silicon IP business. Now, what I think you'll start to see in the coming years is that 300 continues to stay roughly flat, will hopefully continue to grow as our silicon IP business grows. But you'll see some structural step downs in the licensing billings that we have as you see that silicon IP business grow. Now, if you look to the right, what you see is very strong growth from a silicon IP and a product perspective. So when we call here products, it's primarily what we sell as buffer chips. Now, as you know, there is some product revenue that we have, a small amount that we have, that's related to our security business as well. So there's some workstations that we sell that are counted as part of our product business. But predominantly, what we report as products is what we sell from a chip perspective. Then the next bar is what you see in contract and other. And again, the majority of the contract and other business is really silicon IP. There is about $20 million a year in architectural licensing or licensing billings that really is more closely related to our silicon IP business. But again, because we don't have any performance obligations, we don't recognize it as revenue under ASC 606. But again, that contract and other bucket is really silicon IP, which is our security cores as well as IP cores. And then what I've shown also in the white box with the dashes around it is businesses that are no longer part of our portfolio. So for example, RLD was a lighting business that we shut down at the beginning of last year in Q1 of 2018, and then our payments and ticketing business as well. As I mentioned previously, our payments ticketing business was about $25 to $30 million last year. We expected it to grow to about $35 or $40 this year. But what you'll see is that as those businesses go away, the structural growth that we have in our product revenue will help us both from a top line and bottom line. As Luke talked about earlier, you know, what we see from a chip perspective is market share gains. As you see new platforms being introduced, and there's still a lot of time left with DDR4, we're consistently able to grow our market share in our chip business, and that's a very nice business for us. You know, that business has about a 50 or 60% gross margin for us, but what you find is that now that our investment there is stable and predictable, is you see operating leverage. So while we ship additional chips, they may be a 50 or 60% gross margin, but I expect them to be a 40% or better operating margin. Then what you also see as well is through continued engagements, both in security as well as memory, a growth in our silicon IP business. Now, one of the things I talked about a few quarters ago is we did have a bit of a step down in our silicon IP business, specifically for our anti-counterfeiting business. We had a one-time true-up, both in terms of actuals as well as forecast, and that's why there's a little bit of lumpiness here on a quarterly basis. What we expect to see is you'll expect to see both of those growing nicely out into the future, and we'd like to continue that growth trajectory. If I go to the next slide, it really is about our balance sheet. We have a very strong, very clean balance sheet. So we ended Q2 with almost $338 million of cash, very small amount of debt for a company our size. We have one convertible debt instrument that's due in Q1 of 2023. We did have a call option on that convert, so it's only dilutive to us when we reach $23.30. So very strong, clean balance sheet. From a contract asset perspective, as I mentioned earlier, with ASC 606, what we record on our balance sheet is an unbilled contract asset associated to those licensing agreements for which we don't have any performance obligations. So as of the end of Q2, we have almost $600 million on our balance sheet. And again, that's discounted to present day value. We have a discount rate associated with each of those contracts for agreements for which we have no performance obligation. So one way to look at it is that we have over $300 million of cash and almost $600 million of assets for which we have no performance obligations. And as Luke mentioned earlier, very strong cash from operations. We've listed quarterly cash from operations for the last five quarters. Obviously, any given quarter, you'll have some variation in terms of just what happens from a receivables or payments perspective. But what I said earlier is that I expect for us to generate over $100 million in cash from operations this year. Go next, just a little more detail on cash. One of the benefits of our company is we have relatively low capital expenditures. On an annual basis, it's typically $10 to $12 million. We'll have a little more at the back half of this year and early next year. As we've announced, we have a new headquarters facility that we're moving to a few miles away from our current building. And so obviously any time you move into a new facility, there's a few million dollars of capital outlay associated with that. But one of the things that's very attractive about Rambus is that predictable revenue stream and that visibility in terms of cash flow. What we've also done as a company has been fairly consistent about returning capital to shareholders. So through 2015 and 2018, we returned $200 million of cash to shareholders through accelerated share repurchase programs. Our practice over the last several years has been to return 40 to 50% of our free cash flow back to our shareholders through repurchase. Obviously, right now, we found uses of cash from a strategic perspective for M&A. In terms of our capital allocation, the first thing that we look at is organic growth. So investing in product programs, which are growing very nicely, whether it's chips or silicon IP. Also investing in R&D, making sure that we continue to invest in our patent portfolio, as Luke showed earlier. Then next is inorganic growth, and you've seen that with the announcements we've made recently with our acquisitions of both Northwest Logic, which we have closed, as well as Verimatrix, which we hope to close in the coming months. And then the third priority would be return to shareholders. To make it a little easier for you to gauge the ins and outs of the company, here what I've provided is a little more context in terms of our expectations around M&A. So specifically what you see on the left-hand side is payments and ticketing. So this is business, again, we hope to close imminently. I know Kit and Jay are working on it. But what we expected is in the second half of 19, that business would have been $20 to $25 million. And we expected in 2020 it would have grown from 35 to 40 this year to 45 to 50 next year. So for those of you who model us, you would necessarily take that out. That payments and ticketing business was roughly break even for us in terms of our internal projections. So you take a corresponding amount of expense out as well for both the back half of 19 as well as 2020. Then we have, in the middle is the Northwest Logic acquisition, which we have closed. I expect that to add about $10 million of revenue for us in 2020. In this Q3, because it's closed, we'll get the prorated amount of expense. But as you know, through acquisition accounting, we can't count any contracts we assume as revenue, so you wouldn't get the same amount. But I do expect it to be roughly $10 million of revenue for us next year. For the business that we are going to acquire from Verimatrix, next year I expect that business to do roughly $20 million of revenue for us. It's a very nice, healthy business. Our focus from an M&A perspective is, one, to make sure that we continue to take care of our customers, also to make sure that we continue to take care of our employees and the partner and the ecosystems. So these are both very nice ads for us and fit very well as part of our company. From a profitability perspective, I expect the two acquisitions to be marginally accretive to our pro forma EPS in 2020, but it really is going to depend on just how the contracts play out and the timing of the close for the business from Verimatrix. What I wanted to do here on slide 40 is to give you now a little more guidance in terms of how we view 2020. I know we've had a lot of parts moving in and out, so the previous slide showed some of those ins and outs, specifically with payments and ticketing going away, and then us acquiring the business from Northwest Logic as well as from Verimatrix. What you see on the left is licensing billings, again, their architectural licensing. So what we expect is that next year, that business, from a billings perspective, we should bill between 220 and 240 million. As a reminder, about 20 million of that, I think, is really related to our silicon IP business, but it's just we don't have a performance obligation associated with it. The second is what we expect to recognize as revenue. Under our reporting, we call it contract and other, so that's really the silicon IP business. And I expect that business to do between $70 and $90 million for us next year from a revenue perspective. I think there's absolutely opportunities for us in all these businesses to do better as well. And then the third is what we have a report as product revenue. Again, that's predominantly what we sell as buffer chips. And I expect that business to do between $75 and $95 million for us next year. So Again, that's predominantly our buffer chip business. Sometimes we do have some product sales in our security business as well, but I think we see our chip business growing very nicely. With each new platform, you see a substantial improvement in terms of our design win momentum, and that's what gives us confidence that we'll continue to grow our revenue as well. On the right side of the page, we have some of our expenses and other pieces. So I expect total operating costs, including COGS, to be between $245 and $265 million. Now, obviously, there isn't any COGS associated with our licensing billings. We do see COGS associated with our product revenue. Again, that's about a 50 or 60% gross margin business. Our silicon IP business tends to be about a 70 or 80% gross margin business, and it's really associated with the engineering teams that we have there. So total operating costs, again, between 245 and 265. I expect to see about $3 million for us from interest income and expense because of the cash balance that we have. And I expect that we'll have, on average over the course of next year, about $115 million of fully diluted shares outstanding. So again, this is our pro forma outlook. This includes royalty revenue of about $40 to $60 million. But I think most people who look at us look at the cash flow that's generated by our licensing billings income instead. Then what I'd like to do after that is to turn it back to Luke for some closing comments, and I'd invite the members of our exec team that are here up on the stage, and we'd be happy to entertain any questions that you may have.
Thanks, Rahul. So as we said earlier, there are a few things that we've done over the last year. One was to simplify the company, refocus the company to our core in semiconductor, high-speed interfaces, and embedded security. We consolidated that through a set of acquisitions and divestitures. We divested our payment and ticketing business. We acquired Northwest Logic and Verimetrics. We're also refocusing our internal R&D efforts onto the patent portfolio that we think is going to be relevant to our long-term future. As we're doing this, we continue to generate cash. As I said, last quarter, we generated $38.7 million of cash, if I remember well. We continue to do that. and we are going to try to continue to simplify our business as we move forward and report our business in a way that will allow you to track us more easily. So this being said, I will leave the stage open to Q&A with the rest of the team. Let people come. We already have two questions. There's one there, one Gary, one's. We're ready, Suji.
Does that sound like where the numbers would fall out based on all the elements you gave?
Hi, Suji. Thanks for your question. So obviously for us, we're on ASC 606, so we have to report our numbers as though we're under 606. But I understand the modeling that you do. And so if you were to substitute the licensing billings for royalty revenue with the guidance we provided, I think, and then run through the P&L, you'd be at about 95 cents.
And just as a curious follow-up to that, are you going to guide license, contract, and product now going forward, or are you going to give the same numbers you've given in the past?
Yes. So we're going to guide those going forward. It's actually very similar to what we provided in the past. I think putting it this way makes it easier for people just to add it up, which is what people are want to do. And so addition seems easier than subtraction. So you should expect that kind of going forward from us.
I think I learned addition first before subtraction, so that makes sense. Can you talk about the product revenue you guided for 20? How much of that is memory buffer, if you can give us a sense? Because, you know, obviously you may not want to break it out, but we want to have a sense of how much memory buffer is growing from the acquisition and what your expectations are kind of going into share and gain and opportunity.
So all of the guidance that we provided for 2020 is really related to that memory buffer business.
There may be some additional product sales, again, associated with our security business, but specifically that guidance was for that memory buffer business, which is growing very nicely.
And one non-finals question, I'll cede the floor. You cited AI, Luke, and ML, machine learning is the place you saw as end market specific memory. Is that the only area you've identified for an application specific memory as opposed to technology as opposed to general, or are there other possibilities like auto and others that might follow there?
So I'll give the first part of the answer, and then I'll let also Gary comment to this. The nice thing with IP cores is that whatever IC people develop specifically for a target market, there's going to be a memory interface. So our play in AI today is really providing some high-speed memory interfaces such as GDDR6 or HBM to people who develop AI-specific chips. And that's going to be the case for other segments as well. Again, as I said earlier, the nice thing about Rambus is that we play at the interface. So long as we increase the bandwidth of those interfaces and we increase the speed of those interfaces and we provide those technologies in the form of silicon IP, then these people can actually integrate this into specific chips that they develop for these emerging markets before, you know, hopefully in the long run, some standard emerged that would say, okay, AI chips or AI architectures should look this way, like we have in data centers today, but that's not the case today. So for today, it's very, very important that we provide those interfaces in the form of silicon IP so that people can have the architecture they want, so long as they have high bandwidth and high speed. And Gary, you wanna add something to this?
Sure, can you hear me?
Yep, so I agree with what Luke said. My perspective on application-specific memories in general is that the market only supports one sort of new kind of memory per decade, practically. Like if I look at the 2000s, GDDR is really what took off when gaming took off. And in the 2010s, when the mobile phone revolution took off, we saw LPDDR really emerging in a big way. Right now, people are using the more conventional memory that's available today, GDDR6 and HBM. To support AI, but it's not really optimized for AI. So I'd say, given the volume of usage we're already seeing for those current standards, I think AI is what looks like the most likely thing to drive something new in the next decade.
My apologies. Gary Mobley with Wells Fargo Securities. I had a question on capital allocation. So, you know, just given all the balls that you have up in the air right now that you're juggling, seems to be a wash in terms of asset sale and purchases, but yet you're still very cash generative and have a healthy balance sheet. And so I wonder if you think you've made all the moves that you need to make and thus perhaps are in a position more so today than just a few months ago to continue with the share buyback, or do you still see a wide number of opportunities out there to grow inorganically?
So thanks, Gary. So as Raul said earlier, our priority is to continue to fuel our growth through M&A. But as we did over the last few months, we are going to only focus on M&A opportunities that build on our core competencies, and so that we strengthen our position in the current markets that we want to play in, memory and embedded security. We have a lot of M&A opportunities. We say no to a lot of them internally because we want to make sure that the one we bring on board makes sense to us, that the people we buy or the companies we buy share the same values we have, that it makes financial sense to us, it makes strategic sense to us, to our customers, or to our employees, and also it makes operational sense. And what I mean by this is that we have the ability to integrate those companies flawlessly, if you wish, and actually build on the growth after acquisition. But this being said, that's our priority. If we don't find the right opportunities for M&A, then we return capital to the shareholders. But I'll let Rahul, maybe Kit, comment on that as well.
I would just say we have a pretty rigorous process that we've developed internally for both vetting M&A opportunities, as well as integrating opportunities after we've gone ahead and made the purchase. So I think those processes include a bunch of checks and balances to make sure that it's a good deal that we're getting, it's the right type of business that we're buying, it's going to be integratable by us as a company. And so I'd say there's a lot more rigor around all of that than maybe historically was the case. So.
If I can add a bit as well, I think what I saw in the industry in 2014 and 15 was a lot of consolidation. And what you've seen in the last few years is companies digesting what they had. And what you're seeing now is more pieces being available. And Kit has done a fantastic job of helping us evaluate those at a very quick pace. There's been a tremendous amount of flow and opportunities. And it's not just whole companies, but also pieces of companies as well. As other companies also focus their strategies, you find pieces that become available that could be very complementary to us. So there are things that are available, both smaller as well as larger, and from a long-term basis for us to complement our existing business, focus on our core and grow would be an excellent use of cash.
There was a question in the front. There's a follow-up there. Sorry.
Thanks. Hi, yeah. Jeff Bernstein from Cowen Advisors. A couple questions. You had a webinar recently. It was about HBM and I guess suggesting it as an architecture for AI. But who's on those calls? What will they do in response to that, and how do you get paid?
Gary, you want to answer that one?
Well, I wasn't on that webinar, but I know what those things are in general. And basically, that's all in support of our IP cores business. And we offer HBM5s as an example. That's a commercial offering you can buy from us. And so if an AI startup needs that kind of an interface for their chip, we would sell it to them through whatever foundry they're working with.
Gotcha. And then, sorry to show my ignorance again, on the crypto side, so you announced a win with Qualcomm and one with Micron. Are those discrete? That's all that has to happen is Qualcomm adopts this and then their stuff is secure? Or is there a whole ecosystem and there are other people that have to be involved and it has a network effect or something?
Can you just talk about that? It depends on the specific technology and the system it's playing in. In that particular case, there is an IP core that they're buying from us. I think it's also publicly known that they use our provisioning solution as well. So as they're buying new cores from us, we're using that same provisioning infrastructure to provision keys to all of those different types of cores. I should also mention, actually, that the provisioning infrastructure will support other cores than just our cores. So we do have, you know, some customers that would buy the provisioning infrastructure and not our cores. So we're agnostic about whether it's our cores or not. It does provide a convenient one-stop shop for somebody that wants both from us. And we feel very good about our cores there, but we're willing to do it agnostic, you know, one or the other, or both.
Hey, sitting here with Deutsche Bank. A couple questions on the licensing business. You talked about the various areas of IP that you address in the chip, as well as in and out the chips. You talked about the chiplet architectures as being used more frequently today. Should we think of the revenue per chip or per system is actually going up? In other words, do you expect Rambus to be more than just a play on unit growth, but also on content increase as well?
Yeah, I'll take that as leading the licensing business. Our licensing deals are structured in a variety of different ways. The big DRAM licensing deals that we have in place, I think most of you know, are fixed in price. So it would have no impact in that particular case. Now, when those come up for renewal, that's an opportunity to maybe change that structure. But I'd say with each, we're not married to a single structure in our licensing business. It really depends on sort of the needs of the licensee in that case. We do have several deals that are royalty bearing, and those can be on a fixed number of cents per chip or even on a percentage of the sales of a business. So we have done it a bunch of different ways depending on the needs of the licensee. And trying to be fair to the industry, I would say, is a key influencer in how we structure the deal. So it's possible that could help with some upside there. But not all necessarily just volume. For example, some of the deals are percentage of revenue based. If the volumes are increasing but the ASP is coming down, you have to look at, you know, which is growing faster type of a thing. So it does depend.
Great. Maybe follow up to that. If you look at that same business, how do you think your customer mix is going to shift over the next few years? You talk about now you're addressing directly the hyperscale guys. How should we think about the mix between cloud, OEMs, chip companies, foundries? I know they overlap, but today versus, let's say, 5 years from now?
My view, and then I'll let probably, you know, Sean, you say a few words, but when you enter a mature market like the buffer chip or data centers today, you know, the architectures are set, and you typically sell your solutions to the people who build the modules, and there's a standard business model. When you go to the cloud people, you have the opportunity to expand the business with them when they enter new markets. Because what these cloud people find is that they don't find in the current architectures the optimal architectures that they need for new markets. So the way they respond to that is they develop their own architectures, and as they develop their own architectures, they approach companies like us as IP providers so that they can develop their own chip based on our IP. And over time, when markets mature, then some standard solutions emerge, and that's a different type of business model. So I think our inroads into the cloud computing companies have to do with the emergence of new applications, the emergence of new markets, where they have to develop their own solutions. And as the chips become more and more complex, people have to specialize. So they turn to people who specialize like us in interfaces or embedded security to find, you know, those solutions with us as they develop their chips. That's the type of engagements we have with them. And whether you want to add things to this.
I think you are absolutely right here. If you look at you know, what's going on the last few years, right, you know, certainly the cloud guys play a bigger and bigger role in the ecosystem. And going forward, you see like Lucas said, the mega trend in AI and machine learning, they require new kind of thinking of from a architecture perspective. But you will also see the platform will become more diversified. And at the end of the day, it's all about bandwidth and security. And we have all the technologies playing into those areas. And we see there's tremendous potential to really grow no matter which platform we're going to win.
Great. Maybe one last for me. For the Northwest Logic acquisition, how should we think about the design cycle for customers to able to use your FIs and the Northwest Logic controller? How should we think about the potential synergies between the two businesses? I assume the customers are the same customers. Thanks.
Yeah, the customers, you're absolutely right. The customers are the same customers. And you know, the customer design cycles dictate, you know, the speed at which we design those things. I would say that from our standpoint, the interesting thing is the fact that Northwest Logic and us are part of the same company today is going to accelerate all the tests we have to do of interoperability. It's very, very important to make sure that the PHY works well, you know, with the controller. In the past, before the acquisition, we were doing this at the customer site. The customer site was integrating the two things and making sure the two things work together. Today, we can do this internally, and when we work on our roadmap, we can actually design the PHY and the controller so that they work better, faster together, and that's going to accelerate our time to market when we go compete with our competitors in the market.
Thank you. Do your license agreements survive a change of control?
Kit, do you want to?
That's a very specific question. So let's see, offhand, yes, the majority of them do, absolutely. Some of them will require some consent and that kind of stuff, but yeah.
The largest ones in the memory space, for example?
Yeah, so yes, they would.
And the cash that's going to come from the closing, is that $75 million this quarter if it does close?
So I think specifically you're referring to the payments and ticketing. The sale price was about $75 million, but I expect about $5 million of costs associated with the lawyers and the bankers. Just let me glare. So then the net proceeds to us would be closer to about $70 million. As I mentioned earlier, Kit and Jay and team are working on it. Not sure if it's going to close by the time Q3 or sometime in Q4.
Hi, just a couple of follow-up questions. You talked about the TAM being $2 billion and the SAM being $1.4 billion. Can you talk about those two acquisitions recently, what they did to the SAM, how much they increased them? Was it a meaningful amount or, you know, and obviously there's more you can go after, so curious about comments there.
I'm not sure I understood the question.
The
sale
and the acquisitions, how much did it increase our share of market, the sum?
Well, you know, we estimate the IP core market for the type of IP that we're playing in to be in the range of $250 million. So, you know, what Rahul shared earlier is, you know, Verimatrix is going to add about $20 million of revenue, and Northwest Logic about $10 million of revenue. So that's the kind of numbers we're looking at.
Yeah. How much the addressable opportunity was.
But right.
The $350 million number helps, but I was curious what the addressable opportunities were, if that's available. Yeah. That's okay. My second question is, Sean's up here, and you know, you've hired a CEO. Correct me if I'm wrong, but I don't believe you've had that role before. If you have, let me know. But curious what you're expecting out of a CEO role, and maybe from Sean, you know, why he joined and what he sees at Rambus as opportunity. That would be helpful to hear.
Why Sean is your question?
Well, among other things.
Sean, you want to answer?
Well, this is getting very personal. Yeah, actually, you know, to be honest with you, and it was a tough decision for me to leave my previous company. After all, I've been there for almost 20 years, you know, going through the ups and downs, and it was a bittersweet exit from there. And actually, when make a decision to join Rambus, actually was pretty easy. And you know, first of all, you know, I know Rambus for a long time, and Rambus has a long history of innovation, and especially under Lucas' leadership in the last few quarters, refocused the company and actually transforming the company's image in the ecosystem. And we have a very strong team and a very supportive the board. I feel like this is a very attractive opportunity for me and at my stage of the career, if you will. And also, just like Luke mentioned earlier, the mega trend in the industry just present us with a lot of opportunities. And Rambus is kind of uniquely positioned in that in this space. Especially, you know, I just got back from Korea, visiting some of my old friends or customers, if you will. And they are very excited that they want us to be successful, because they want Rambus, you know, is the only single US-based buffer chip company and technology company in the memory space. So I feel very excited to join Rambus, and hopefully, you know, we'll see, you know, better days ahead of us.
Sean is very humble. You know, from our standpoint, as we generate that growth in the product side and the IP core side, it's very important that we adapt our culture to that, and that we bring talents on board who have experience in growing product business organically and inorganically from the industry. We have a heritage of being a licensing company. Licensing is still very important to us, but it's also important to us to move the culture to a very fast, aggressive culture of product growth. And in order to do so, you know, we need to bring on board leaders from the industry. And Sean, you know, has proven at IDT, now Renesas, that he's been able to grow business organically and inorganically. So we're very pleased to have Sean on board.
Would there be any reason to think that Micron would exercise its option to renew ahead of the expiration on Q3 of next year, just given, you know, how much higher the memory market is today versus when that deal was originally signed? And can you speak in a little more detail about the prospects of monetizing the patents over in China, just given the, you know, large investments being made over in that region, and whether it's predicated on, you know, their desire to export versus just sole source or internally source?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, a couple of good questions there. So, so Micron does have an extension option that is during Q3 of next year. There's not much negotiation involved in that. All the terms are set, so that's really an example where they would notify us of their intent to extend, and it's pretty much that straightforward. There's a window of time that they need to do that in, and so I don't expect it to happen before or after that. It will be during that window of time. We definitely would expect them to renew. As you say, the rates don't move for them, so it's a pretty good deal given that their business has grown pretty significantly since we originally signed that deal several years ago. So that's the timing for that, and that's when we would expect that to happen in Q3 of next year. The question about licensing in China is an interesting one, and I think generally in the industry, there are a lot of questions about how effective particularly US companies, but all companies have been in licensing patent portfolios in China. I think the situation is improving. We see that, and others in the industry see that. I think we're starting to invest more now in our patent portfolio in China for those reasons. I think there's no question if a Chinese-based company were to develop a business that extended beyond China, obviously we're very strong in our patent portfolio, so it really comes down to how effective will we be getting some licensing deals maybe with the emerging winners in China. I think any of those companies, their products end up overseas anyway, internationally, and don't just stay domestic. And with the way the patent rules work, you know, that works okay for us too. So I think we do have a decent licensing opportunity in China. And it would only really matter for us from a revenue perspective as those businesses grow. So it's going to take some time, but we do see that as an upside opportunity for our business because obviously they won't impact our big fixed licensing deals and they would be additive revenue then on top of that.
Can I just on the licensing billings, if we assume a Micron renews the deal next year to extend, so does that mean through roughly, I guess, 2023, for the next couple of years, that number stays sort of roughly constant, the 220 to 240?
Yes, that's a very good assumption to use, right? Because our expectation is we would see that renewal next year, and then out of the big three, the other ones come up then again in 23 and in 24. So I would expect that to be relatively stable. Now, as Kit just talked about, I think we are unique in that we're one of the few companies where China is actually an upside for us. So anything that could happen for us from a licensing perspective in China could be upside to those numbers. It's hard to predict the timing and scale. The conversations we have internally revolve around, are we better off doing a license earlier and taking cash earlier, are we better off waiting to maybe there's a bigger license or can we somehow do both? Also what we look at is what's our structure. You know, we have a existing joint venture in China specifically for resistive RAM, and is that a way for us to also monetize the tens of billions of dollars that's being invested in a domestic industry in China? But I think your initial assumption is about right. You know, what we have is that we have that very solid, predictable backbone of our IP business that's been about $300 million, and it has been about $250 of the licensing, about $50 of the silicon IP. And you see some of the structural step downs to get to the range that I talked about earlier, but then offset by growth in silicon IP as well as chips as well as other potential M&A.
Okay. And then when we think of sort of long term, just the operating margins and the leverage, how should we view sort of growth in the contract silicon IP and product revenues as that grows in the future years versus your OpEx?
Sure. So as I spoke about earlier, the gross margins in that chip business should be in the 50 to 60% range, really just depending on mix. And certainly as we get more volume, you'll see us at the higher end of that. The operating margins in that business should be in the 40% plus because our infrastructure there is already built. We have the engineering teams in place. It's really three big customers who are the same partners that we have in the other parts of our business. We're also fabless, so there is some incremental infrastructure that we need, but not significant. So as we ship more chips and continue to grow in volume, you should expect to see 40% or greater operating margin. I also expect to see roughly 40% operating margin in the growth in the silicon IP business. So that tends to be about a 70 or 80% gross margin business, but there is a significant amount of effort that's put into those engagements. And so usually you'll put in 30 to 40% just from an R&D perspective. Again, it gets you to about a 40% incremental operating margin. So while we see top line growth and you'll see a bit of a gross margin mix as those products grow, both on the chip side as well as silicon IP, you should see nice growth from an operating margin perspective.
There's another question there.
Oh, hold on, microphone.
In terms of the chip business, what are your ambitions in terms of derivatives? Would you actually make a chip for a cloud guy who had a specific kind of architecture that they thought they were going to grow a lot, or just, you know, talk about what opportunities there are and how big your ambitions are. I hear that on the leading edge now, mask sets are up to $30 or $40 million kind of thing. So okay. How big of a bet are you willing to make?
Okay, that's a good question. Actually, you know, first of all, we do not need leading edge technology to develop the buffer chip. You know, actually, most of our chips are using pretty trailing edge. I don't know if we disclose.
40 nanometer.
Yeah, we disclosed before 40 nano today. Mm-hmm. We may move to 28. I don't see anytime soon we will need sub 10 micron technology for those buffer chips at all. Okay, so that's the number one. Number two, you said earlier, even today when we offer, you know, standard JEDEC compliant devices, right? You can still, you know, differentiate your device, you know, at a certain customer, especially, you know, at some customers, especially the cloud guys, they have special requirements. We can certainly do some customization. And also going forward, you know, it's very possible that we have customer sponsorship, do some special derivatives of those products, target for specific application or platforms, and as long as we have right ROI justification.
And if I may, thanks, Sean, if I may add to this, for the chips we deliver, we don't need the leading edge technologies. But for the cloud guys who develop their own chips where, you know, the technologies are very thin and the mass costs are very, very high, they incur those costs because they design the chip themselves, they invest in their own R&D, they invest in the mass set, and they invest in buying IP from us that they integrate on the chip. So they actually incur the costs and we get the revenue from the IP engagement. Any other questions? No? Well, thank you then, and we'll be happy to see you at the party, cocktail party. Thank you.
Yeah. Thank you very much.